Okay, I'm calling this meeting of council to order on December 4th. Roll call, please.
Boyd. Cobb. Kuda.
Here.
Hart.
Here.
Larson.
Here.
Maddox.
Here.
Russell.
Here.
Okay, amendment to the agenda.
Yes, Madam President, I would like to make a motion to amend the agenda in the following regard. Ordinance number 194-2023, a motion to have that be a first reading only, and that's on ARPA spending. We will amend the agenda to table 190-2023, which is a proposed ordinance amending chapter 1347. A motion to table that until February 5th. And then finally, as part of the motion to amend the agenda, we would like to add to the agenda 198-2023, which is the proposed budget from the administration, to add that to the agenda as a first reading.
So moved.
Okay.
Discussion on this?
No, we don't.
Do a roll call on this.
Maddox.
Aye.
Larson.
Aye.
Boyd. Cobb.
Yes.
Kuda.
Aye.
Russell.
Aye.
Hart.
Aye. Okay, you should have gotten your minutes for November 6th and November 13th and handed in any corrections. So if there are no objections, then we will consider those amended and approved. Okay, next we have a presentation from Sal Russo, owner of 1248 Cedar Road, and so we'll hear from him.
Just very briefly, I am not Sal Russo, but I am Brian Anderson, Assistant Director for Economic Development. Just as a brief introduction, the agenda says Sal Russo, as well as representatives from Grocery Outlet. Unfortunately, that representative was not able to join Sal today for personal/health reasons, maybe at a future meeting. But the city has been working with, you know, the Russo family, who are the owners of the now vacant grocery store in Cedar Fairmount. I think they very much understand the importance of that location being a grocery store for that neighborhood. And they wanted to give an update both to council and the community as a whole, kind of where they've been and where they are at, you know, in that process and some of the challenges associated with filling retail and grocery space in the current environment. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Brian.
Good evening, council. Thank you for inviting me here. My father's here as well. I'm here to give you an understanding of who we are, what we're asking for, and why we're asking for it. And this is all, as Brian said, as relates to finding a replacement for the Dave's supermarket at Cedar and Fairmount. So to start with who we are, I made this presentation as, you know, the initial slide shows. We have over 92 years of history and involvement in Cleveland Heights. So we put a little timeline together. This is my great uncle, Tony Orlando, at the Fairmount and Cedar Fruit Market circa 1940, running the cash register. This is a footprint of that store, which was actually in the Heights Medical Building next door to the Cedar Grandview Building, basically where the current Fairmount Martini and Cocktail Bar is. Of note on this site plan, and the site plan is recurring throughout, you can see that where the two existing parking lots are currently at this time, there were 10 single-family homes and 3 apartment buildings. The next sort of era of Russo Stop and Shop was 51 to 60. This is a Cleveland News article, October 18, 1951. In the photograph is my grandfather, Sam, my uncle, John, the butcher, the head butcher, and the store manager. During these years, my grandfather had moved from the Heights Medical Building into approximately 3,300 square feet in the Cedar Grandview building. 1961 to 1968, another article featuring my grandfather, Sam, who was buying produce at the Cleveland Food Terminal, 3 a.m. The lower pictures, my Uncle Jim in the meat department, my Uncle John in the wine department. During this era, this is the storefront of the grocery market, the Cedar Grandview building. This is an...
Lamb tops, 49 cents a pound.
So those were the days. So we doubled our square footage at that time. So this is an aerial photograph of that era. This is circa 1961. Of note is the small parking lot behind the Cedar Grandview building. So already we've acquired one single family home and one apartment to make the parking lot you see there. You can see as you go south, you can see there are two more apartment buildings and three more homes where the current primary lot is. And then if you look across Grandview, most of you can probably make out where the Firestone is. You can see the homes that are behind Firestone and Heights Church and the gas station. This is the site plan showing that the store was expanded and that the parking lot was rather small at the time. 1969 to 1984, 69 was a major expansion and remodel. The photograph there shows the new exterior facade. Picture my grandfather Sam, my Uncle John, my dad Sal, and my Uncle Jim. There's some uncertainty on our end if we actually started in 31 or 32. This is behind the checkouts at the 1969 grand opening. My grandfather with one of his first customers who had been shopping since 1931. My dad in the produce department, my Uncle Jim. My Uncle Jim in the meat department, my Uncle John in the wine department, so 69 to 84, and then a more clear picture of the storefront in that era. And then another aerial showing that prior to us expanding the store, we had acquired the two apartment buildings and three additional homes. We built the parking lot, the primary lot, the lot across the street had yet to be built. And then this is an aerial, I think it was taken, it shows lot 22 as existed from 1977 to 2019. So this was one of our first partnerships with the city. We donated the two homes that were sitting there and the city built the lot. And then we purchased all of the permits for as long as the lot was in existence. So during this era, it was Russo's Stop and Shop. We had 18,000 feet. We had basically everything except Merit Drug, which is the lighter rectangle in the front corner. And you can see the site plan reflects the lot and lot 22. 1985 was the last remodel that we did. So about 15 years on from the prior remodel, my grandfather and my grandmother were still involved in the business at that time. And then in 1999, we sold our four stores to Giant Eagle. This is a Cleveland Plain Dealer article. When we sold to Giant Eagle, they immediately wanted to double the size of the store. They wanted to convert Grandview Avenue into a cul-de-sac, build a 45,000 square foot store. The residents were not in favor of doing that, and the store remained the size that it is. Site plan showing that, 20,000 square feet, lot 22 and the primary lot. This is the article, but well, the previous article was us selling. This is the article about Giant Eagle's expansion plans that they did not move forward with. And so this would be 2000 to 2018. It was a combination of Giant Eagle and Dave's. 2013, we did a grind off and resurfacing of the parking lot. This was the footprint of the store, 22,000 square feet. And then this is a 2020 aerial photograph showing, so I would say about 2017, we were negotiating with Dave's on a renewal. We were simultaneously negotiating with other potential grocers, and all of the candidates that came and saw the store were insistent that we add parking, that we build parking. And so this timing coincided when the city was, well, shortly thereafter, it coincided when the city was looking for temporary parking for the Ascent. And that's how we got the lot built. This is a Cleveland.com article about that development agreement with the city. The images of the fire department running through practice on the two homes before they were torn down. These are some photographs we took during the lot construction. The bottom center is the shared driveway in between the two homes. The right picture is the extensive underground stormwater retention and otherwise just constructing the lot. This is basically the current site plan, the store, 22,000 square feet, and the two parking lots. And then this is a Crane's Cleveland Business article with our friend Doug Katz pictured, and the gist was that we should find another grocer, we should take our time and find the right long-term fit. And this is one of the grocers that we are in discussions with. So that's really a synopsis of who we are. What we're asking for and why we're asking for it. I just made a few notes. I'll try and get through them briefly, and then I'm happy to answer any questions. Why we're asking for financial support from the city. We're asking because a grocery store is the highest and best use for the property, and public money is of vital importance to securing a grocery store. Put simply, without your support, we cannot deliver a grocery store. We know this from our 92 years experience, as we just went through. City officials have expressed the same priority. Cleveland Heights residents frequently contact me seeking reassurance that the next tenant will be a grocery store. The developer of the Ascent, and indeed all the developer candidates, were keen to highlight the presence of a neighborhood grocery store within walking distance. We've known for over 2 years that Dave's was leaving, and we've been actively marketing to grocers ever since. All of the genuinely interested candidates required city support. The operator who was receiving public money elsewhere required city support. The operator who would only proceed if we were to demolish our 100-year-old building and lease the land so that they could build their prototypical or traditional prototype, which would be in stark contrast to the existing English Tudor architecture, required city support. The operator who would only proceed if we build a 10,000 square foot addition and was unable to pay rent to reimburse the construction cost, let alone a market return on the investment, required city support. The operator who would only proceed if we were to build a grade level dock on Grandview Avenue required city support. The most recent operator, whose rents decreased 27% compared to the prior operator, while the CPI increased 21% over the same 5-year period, required city support. So in a nutshell, we've done our due diligence, and it is shown that for most grocery store operators, the building is non-conforming with today's industry standards. It is nonetheless the size, the scale, and the appearance that is preferred by the community. We've gone to great lengths in our prior leases to preserve the grocery store use. We've passed on non-grocery store usage, which would not best serve the community and which lack longevity of viability. We're in this for the long run. We've shown by our history that constant reinvestment is required. As the presentation noted, 10 single-family homes and 3 apartment buildings have been repurposed. Remodels occurred every 10 to 15 years. We've partnered with the city before, including Lot 22 and the current Grandview Belfield lot, which serves the entire Cedar Fairmont district. And then finally combined, the landlord and tenant will be making capital investments several times over the amount requested from the city. This will be a brand new state-of-the-art grocery store. And I think Brian added some pictures. Again, we're in discussions with Grocery Outlet, but my point of saying all this is that no matter the grocery store use, we will need support, and that's why we're asking. But Grocery Outlet would be a traditional grocery store with all the customary products and offerings. These are images from a store of similar size that they just opened in Boardman a couple weeks ago. And my dad and I visited over the weekend. And that's it. I'm happy to answer any questions if you have them. And again, thank you for your time.
Yes, Councilor?
I don't have any questions. I just want to make a statement. I want to thank you and your family for your commitment to Cleveland Heights and your commitment to continuing to make sure that this area has a grocery store. Your strong commitment to this community, it just goes beyond what words can describe. And I definitely understand the weight that this carries and how the economics have shifted in terms of grocery. And so I just wanted to just say that publicly. I absolutely appreciate you and your family for the commitment and dedication you've shown to the city of Cleveland Heights and the impact that you all have made as well. And thank you for your commitment to trying to do what you can to make sure that there's a grocery in that area.
Thank you.
It's greatly appreciated. You could have put anything there. You all could have done anything, but you chose to work to try to make this area stable. And so thank you.
Thank you.
Nice if you can take that same grocery store. I'm sorry. Take that same grocery store and take it to the Noble area.
You never know. I think they're opening 4 stores in a very short time. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor Kuda?
So would it be rude to ask how much money you're looking for?
My answer, oh, man.
I guess, long story short, this is not a negotiation session. This was an introduction of the project and the concept and an update for the community of what we have going on here. So there's going to be a lot of numbers and back and forth involved on what that may or may not look like. So I wanted to take Sal off the hot seat.
I heard the pitter patter. Listen, I'd love to see it happen. You know, so thank you.
Yes.
I think it would be helpful if you could share with us some of the challenges of that space and the difficulties that you've had in trying to get another grocer to come in there, and then you know the market forces that are at play. Just so, you know, those of us that aren't familiar with this will have some information and will feel more comfortable when you come to ask for a specific dollar amount.
Well, for starters, it was as we mentioned, the parking. Everyone that looked at it when the lease was transitioning from Giant Eagle to Dave's said they looked at the parking. The primary lot had 80 spaces. Lot 22 had roughly a dozen, but they were all permit holders. They were all the second floor office tenants. And they just said, there's not enough parking. If all the representatives told us, if you want us to even consider your site, you know, we would mention that we own the land and we own the houses and that we had a good relationship with the city. And they would say, you can't just promise that it'll happen. You actually have to build the lot. So we're thankful that we got that done. other challenges with the infrastructure. We unloaded everything on a dock. The only docks at the store unload on a mezzanine level, which means everything has to be handled by hand and put on conveyors and sent either down to the sales floor or further down into the basement. Every operator that's looked at the store has said, we want you to mothball the basement. We don't want anything to do with it. We don't want our employees going down there. We built a mezzanine and we put in a full kitchen and a full bakery, and we ran our bakery and our catering operation out of it. So we made a significant investment. Everyone that's looked at it says, tear it out. The ceiling below the mezzanine is too low. We want a consistent ceiling height. So that's factored into this project, is ripping out our mezzanine. The receiving's a challenge. Like I said, the docks are on the mezzanine. Nobody wants that. You know, we're fortunate, Grocery Outlet and a few others, but by far the exception, are willing to just unload, as Dave's did, on Grandview Avenue with a forklift, drop the pallets to the ground, deal with the elements, deal with the winter weather, and get them in. But you know, a number of tenants said, no, we can only do it if you give us a grade level dock on Grandview Avenue, which means a 80-foot ramp to get down to the dock being at grade level. Lower ceilings, the parking lot, part of the parking lot being across the street, so it not just being one lot that's immediately adjacent to the site. And really the size. I mean, it's 22,000 square feet. That's, you know, that's the exception. Most grocers want to be much bigger than that. A handful, like say a Trader Joe's, is 12 to 14,000 feet. And then trying to subdivide a 100-year-old building and all the utilities and everything that would be involved and give access to multiple tenants is a huge challenge. That's off the top of my head, most of it. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Sure.
Anything else? Thank you, and
thank you very much. This. Appreciate it.
Appreciate it. Okay, communications from the mayor.
Thank you, Madam President. It has been a long night already, so I have no comments this evening.
Okay, thank you. City Administrator's report.
Madam President, no report this evening.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Any departmental reports? No. Okay, report of the Clerk of Council.
Nothing to report.
Okay. Okay, now we have public comment on legislative items only. And there's a 3-minute time limit. The clock will click down, and then it'll make a little tiny beeping noise, which you can hardly hear, but listen for it, and then if you go over, I'll gavel so that you know you're over. Go ahead.
CJ Nash.
Hello, this probably won't take too long. If anybody watching this missed the meeting that Anthony Maddox had before the Cal meeting, and you're interested in the storage, the shipping containers, watch that. It's helpful. It was helpful for me because there was a lot of information I did not have, and I appreciated the information. One of the things that I would request, this of course is in the ARPA, one of the things that I would request that go into consideration is, if for some reason the pilot project does not work, what will happen with those shipping containers? Is there some way we can designate exactly what will happen with them? And the reason I'm very concerned with that is because historically, junky stuff goes in the Noble area. And we've got what, of course, many of us call the Noble dump. And my fear is that if for some reason it does not come to pass that it works out, that those shipping containers would be shoved into that area and just rust. So my request is, as you're considering how you want to go forward with that, whether you will or will not, take into consideration what will happen with the shipping containers if it does not work out. Thank you.
Thank you, CJ.
Paul Volpe.
Good evening, Paul Volpe, 2593 Fairmount. I thought it might be value to come tonight and speak to a couple of pieces of legislation that you have that I think are very, very important and valuable. And I've been following them for months now, and I'm glad to see the legislation written out, very much to my satisfaction. The first is the proposal to empower the CIC, the Community Investment Corporation. I think it's a tremendous idea. The structure of it is put together right. There's citizen involvement. It's critically important for us to have this functioning. From my experience in architecture and development, both of which I'm doing and trying to do in Cleveland Heights, we have to think of our land, our vacant land, municipally owned, as an asset, an opportunity, not as a liability. Big cities are doing this all over, and for a city like us to have all this property that is generally stagnating is avoidable. And I think the CIC is the way to attack that. So I'm really glad to see it, and I can't wait to pass it and get it going. The second thing is the Arts Commission. In my career as an architect and an arts advocate, I've been on many commissions, selection committees for arts and architecture and awards presentations, and I served as one of the founding members of Cleveland Public Art and was the chairman for 2 3-year terms. If you've heard of it, it's now, that was in the 90s, it's now Land Studio, and is responsible for millions and millions and millions of dollars of tremendous public art in the city of Cleveland. We did great things, and that kind of energy and excitement can happen here in Cleveland Heights, and I think the commission is the right way to do it. Again, it has citizen involvement in both of those pieces of legislation. That is included, and it also stipulates that at least some of, if not most of the people on a citizen level would have professional qualifications to support the activities of those commissions. So I'm just delighted. I'm thrilled. I hope you pass it.
Thank you very much, Paul.
Jack Slater.
This is not a current piece of legislation that I'm speaking on. Does that? All right. Pull my notes here real quick. My name is Jack Slater. I am here as a member of the Northeast Ohio Party for Socialism and Liberation. I want to discuss a resolution that you passed on October 16th unanimously. In that resolution, you all declared support for Israel's right to defend itself in the ongoing war in Palestine. At that point, Israel was already a week into its genocidal bombing campaign, an indiscriminate attack on Gaza, in which civilians are not merely collateral damage, but the primary targets of the attack. At the point of passing that resolution, they had already killed more than twice the number of Palestinians as Israelis died in the attack on October 6th. We see now, 60 days into this campaign, what Israeli self-defense really looks like. 339 schools destroyed, 167 churches and mosques destroyed, 26 of 35 hospitals in Gaza non-functional, 80% of homes in Gaza destroyed. 15,000 civilians killed, another 40,000 injured in Gaza, 254 in the West Bank, where there is no Hamas, and another 3,300 injured there. Of those civilians killed, some 7,000 have been children. Israel passes all this off as necessary because of human shields, a claim for which evidence has never been provided. And even if it were true, those actions would still, by any definition, be a war crime. Or if there were a suspected terrorist in Boulevard Elementary, would you endorse an airstrike on our students? I am here tonight to introduce a resolution that I think you should pass in solidarity with the people of Gaza and Palestine. I'll give it to you after I'm done speaking. I hope you pass this because otherwise you have utterly and irrevocably sabotaged whatever progressive humanist credentials you imagine yourselves to hold by this conscious act of wanton callousness. Mr. Mayor, you quoted James Baldwin in defense of this resolution. I don't have time to read this full quote, but I'd like to take a statement from James Baldwin where he says, "The state of Israel was not created for the salvation of the Jews. It was created for the salvation of Western interests. This is what is becoming clear. The Palestinians have been paying for the British colonial policy of divide and rule and for Europe's guilty Christian conscience for more than 30 years. There is absolutely, repeat, absolutely no hope of establishing peace in what Europe so arrogantly calls the Middle East without dealing with the Palestinians. We see now what it means for the US and Israel to deal with the Palestinians: ethnic cleansing, mass death, land theft, and genocide. You declared with full knowledge your support for these actions. After this meeting, you will return safely home to comfort to your families. The people of Gaza, and indeed of all of Palestine, have had this basic right denied to them and will never have it again if the so-called lie of Israeli self-defense is upheld at all costs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sue Dean Dyke.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
I was going to comment on how important I felt it was to actually vote on ARPA funds today. I did not watch the previous meeting. I don't understand why we are not going to talk about that today. I don't see it on the agenda. But I'm just, what I do want to ask for, because right now I don't know who's accountable, right? Who's accountable for holding up the allocation of the funds? I want to know why the funds aren't being distributed to the organizations that need the money now. My understanding is you can allocate all of that and then just work on the things that you're still trying to decide on. But again, getting back to the accountability, I would really like to see, and I don't know who would do this, who on the council proposes certain legislation, what that legislation is, and you know, you don't need to really do resolutions, or maybe you can do resolutions, but I think they should be marked as such. And it would be really nice to see, just like at the State House, they actually have who's the sponsor and the co-sponsor of certain pieces of legislation, because my concern is that that there is a lot of talk on city council and no actual execution of legislation. And so I think the ARPA funds are a really good example of things just getting held up, and it doesn't seem like there's a really good reason. And maybe somebody can explain that to me, but I just don't understand. You know, we've already taken care of the sewer lines. You know, that project, you know, even though people complained about it, was a good project and it got done. And my understanding is those were paid for with ARPA funds. But all these other communities like Coventry, I mean, we were just there the other day, we're walking in the garage, we're looking around, and it's sad. It's really sad. And I'm just really hoping that we don't hold up any other community organizations. I mean, they have to make their plans for next year. They have to hire, they have to do all of these things, and next year is in 3 weeks. So I really hope that we will pass this before the end, ARPA funds, before the end of this administration. Is there any hope for that?
Yes, there is. We will be voting on it on the 18th. The reason we're not voting on it tonight is that we got a revised budget, and part of the funds we're using for things in the city as well. So our omnibus legislation, we're going to make a slight alteration to it as we look at the budget. We meet with the consultant on Wednesday, because some things require a program, and also we require a contract with the not-for-profits, so we have to get their input on that. So they should be seeing something coming out. I don't know how long it takes to dispense money, but at the city. But I would estimate they would have it at the beginning of the year sometime.
Okay, that's good. And does ARPA, the approval of funds, require three readings?
No.
Okay,
it
good.
Does not.
Good.
It does
that's
not.
That's good to know, because that's and what I was a little worried about.
We will be altering it and putting it forth next the next meeting on the 18th.
Okay. And then one final plug. Thank you. I appreciate mm-hmm. that. People are out circulating petitions to end gerrymandering in Ohio. I hope you all are interested in doing that. And if you're a registered voter and haven't signed yet, please come and sign my petition today. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all for agenda items.
Okay, so legislation. If you have the agenda, you'll see it says first reading, consideration, or adoption. That is moving to first reading only.
All right, so for
go ahead and start reading.
First readings only. I have ordinance number 194-2023 on first reading, an ordinance authorizing the allocation, appropriation, and expenditure of ARPA funds and declaring the necessity that this legislation become immediately effective as an emergency measure, introduced by council members Hart, Maddox, Larson, Russell, and Boyd. Next, I have ordinance number 195-2023 on first reading, an ordinance amending ordinance number 13-2019, as amended by ordinance number 11-2022 to expand the board of directors of the Cleveland Heights Community Improvement Corporation to achieve greater community representation and expertise, modifying the ex officio membership of the board by replacing the director of housing with the director of the Department of Planning and Development, and authorizing the mayor to file appropriate amended articles of incorporation, introduced by Vice President Cobb and Councilmember Maddox. Next, I have ordinance number 196-2023 on first reading, an ordinance repealing Chapter 150, Transportation and Environmental Sustainability Committee of Part 1, Administrative Code of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, and adopting a replacement Chapter 150, Transportation and Mobility Committee, introduced by Vice President Cobb. Next, I have ordinance number 197-2023 on first reading, an ordinance enacting and adopting a new Chapter 140 Cleveland Heights Climate and Environmental Sustainability Committee of Part 1 Administrative Code of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights. Finally, for first readings, I have ordinance number 198-2023 on first reading, introduced by Mayor Sarin, an ordinance to make appropriations for the current expenses and other expenditures of the City of Cleveland Heights, Ohio, for the period of January 1st, 2024 through December 31st, 2024, and declaring the necessity that this legislation become immediately effective as an emergency measure. Continue. Moving on to second readings. I have ordinance number 189-2023 on second reading, an ordinance enacting and adopting a new Chapter 146 to be entitled Parks and Recreation Youth Advisory Board, introduced by Councilmember Russell.
Okay. Is there a
motion? We're
you're going to go to the next one. Okay. You're going to go to the second one. Okay.
Next, I have resolution number 190. We will not be voting on this tonight. Resolution number 190-2023 on second reading, an ordinance amending Chapter 1347, Certificate of Occupancy and Lead Safe Certification of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights to adopt and enact a new Section 1347.14 to be entitled Transient Rentals, amending Section 1341 Definitions to adopt a new subsection 1341.251 to be entitled Transient Rentals, and amending subsection A of Section 1345-99 Penalty. As announced in the beginning of this meeting, this will be tabled to...
It's tabled, yes. Mm-hmm.
Resolution number 193-2023 on second reading, a resolution authorizing the mayor to enter into a development agreement with WXZ CPV LLC concerning the redevelopment of the Taylor Tudor buildings and declaring the necessity that this legislation become immediately effective as an emergency measure.
And that will move to a third reading.
Okay, moving on to third readings tonight, I have ordinance number 123-2023 on third reading, an ordinance amending Part 1, Title 5 of the Administrative Code of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights to enact a new Chapter 142 Arts Commission to establish an arts commission for the city of Cleveland Heights and provide for appointment, powers, and duties of the commission, and declaring the necessity that this legislation become immediately effective as an emergency measure, introduced by Mayor Sarin.
Madam President.
Yes.
I just speak very, very briefly, and I wanted to provide an option for council to accept this proposed substitute with amendments, not for passage this evening, but to replace the version that is currently in the agenda so that upon the next reading, it will be on the agenda as the proposed substitute as opposed to the current version.
Thank you, Mayor. That will go on to the next reading.
Madam President?
We want time to review it, right?
Mayor, could you add, now I may have missed it because you just handed it to us. Could you add a section about the application process? I think that was, if you thought that was something.
Probably it'd be addressed after with him, if you want.
What do you mean after what?
After the meeting, because he can always amend it again and give it to us.
Okay, I don't know why I couldn't finish that sentence, but.
Madam President. Thank you. Councilman Kuda, if you'd like to discuss additional amendments to this legislation, we can have that discussion after the meeting.
Okay, so that will go on, and then we'll get whatever the next version is from you.
Okay, finally, I have ordinance number 179-2023 on third reading as amended. An ordinance authorizing the allocation, appropriation, and expenditure of ARPA funds, introduced by all council members.
Okay, and this one will also go to third reading?
Fourth reading.
And that's because we got a new budget and we need to make sure that we have the allocations of the ARPA correct for that. Okay, so not much legislated on today. So we'll go on to, we don't have any public comments?
Yeah, we do.
We do, okay, go ahead. We'll do that first, and then we'll do committee reports.
Alana Baldwin.
Alana Baldwin, 2648 Canterbury. All right. Mayor Sarin and city council members, when news came out last week that the ice rink opening was delayed, many of you, I think all of you, were inundated with emails and phone calls demanding an explanation and improved plan. And while I appreciate the response and the open drink, I truly do, I feel the need to explain to all of you the bigger source of our mutual outrage. According to the U.S. Census in 2023, the population of Cleveland Heights was about 43,620, and a little over 7,400 of those were youth. If we assume that at least one parent per child, then about 34% of our city population are kids or their parents. And so many of us feel like either an afterthought to the city at best, or at worst, we feel like a problem that you all wish would just go away. And I swear it's not just hockey families. I posted on Facebook last week, do you feel like the city of Cleveland Heights supports families? And here are just a number of the responses that I received. There's no more safety town, talk of not opening the pool, no baby pool, limited basketball gym. It feels like families of all colors in class are an afterthought. By not having easily accessible public activities, families stay separate, assumptions are made, and commitment to community drops. My husband and I talk about this all the time. So many programs have been cut or aren't supported, so they just fail anyway. It's just such a shame. Without community engagement opportunities, diversity suffers. And these two break my heart. I would have a hard time convincing families to move here. And I love Cleveland Heights, but I don't feel like Cleveland Heights loves us back. Meanwhile, I heard multiple parents comment that I can't figure out why it feels like the city government hates our public schools. And private school parents are telling they wish there were more opportunities to interact with and feel fully accepted by the community. Literally no one is happy. So last time I was here talking about the rink, there was a mother, nothing to do with skating, who came at the end and she asked you guys how you were going to keep her baby safe. Her child had been attacked. I don't know any details, but I think some of you remember that. She's like, what are you going to do to keep my child safe? They're not safe going out. What are you going to do to help them? And as I was sitting here in my seat, all I kept thinking was like, give her child a safe place to be. When I was a young teen, we had Friday night open skate at the rec center. For a few years, I enjoyed skating, and for more years, I went to hang out there with my friends. And when I inevitably acted like a fool, you'd better believe that one of the adults there was going to tell my mother about it. We also had Safety Town. We had Arts and Crafts in Denison Park. We had active community services, soccer and baseball programs. These were all ways that my community was looking out for me and helping me grow. And like, Cleveland Heights doesn't offer any of that support to our families anymore. We do have programs, but not like we did when many of us were coming up. I understand that we're building apartments and condos and we're hoping to bring young professionals to our city. Good. I'll leave it at this. I hear that many young professionals end up making babies and those babies turn into children. And what's the point of bringing them here if they're just gonna run to Shaker and Beechwood? That's all.
Thank you.
Robin Coslin.
Hi, you have my family here now. I'm here to talk about severance, but you're going to listen to me diverge first. I have insomnia, and I go to sleep listening to Winnie the Pooh. And I've decided that Cleveland Heights is stuck in Eeyore. We are a bunch of people who have just decided that we can't have good things, and we have oh well in our minds. And we're not fighting for the best we can be. And so what's this got to do with severance? One of the people running for council who didn't win had an idea about severance. She thought we should have a vacancy tax for landlords, and that wasn't just severance, who aren't actively trying to get their property rented out. I think we need to pursue that. I want our law department to do that. I know it's not easy, but I think we have to look at good ideas wherever they are. The other thing, Wall Street Journal had an article about NAMDAR. Did everybody read it, I hope? The first thing you need to do is enact that legislation saying that they can't divvy up that piece of property. And that's exactly what they've been doing everywhere. And the best thing we can do is make that one piece of property, and then they've got a problem. And again, it's not going to be easy, but it's time for us to quit being victims and just saying, okay, I love Cleveland Heights, but it's not like what it used to be. And the last thing I've heard of is a solution to severance is fining for impermeable surfaces. We need to go after them actively, not passively. And I realize this is going to take a long time, but it's too bad we didn't start this 5 years ago. But if we don't start it now, we'll be talking about this for the next 10 years. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jennifer Bartlett.
Council members Larson, Kuda, Russell, and Boyd, I've been emailing stuff with North Rink for the past weeks or so as things have been going on, and I do thank you for responding to me to say that you can't respond to me. The rest of my comments are directed to Mr. Sarin. Mr. Sarin, thank you for opening the rink this week. My kids got to skate this morning for their first practice at Heights in a year. Benedict and Hockey was very pleased to be there. My son was very excited to see the glass was clear, the boards were white. He didn't care one whit about what the walls looked like. He wanted to see the ice. I understand that wanting to paint is a great idea. I understand that wanting to make the place look nice is wonderful. However, communication has been lacking. I know that you communicated this week because we kind of forced your hand. We were very persistent, and we're going to continue to be persistent because we want effective communication. And it's really hard when it's bottlenecked to one person. Every time I called anyone, everyone directed me to you. And you're very hard to get a hold of. So all I had to do was just sit and wait for emails to come. And they came in the evening. I know you're very busy, and I do appreciate you taking late hours to respond to us. I know that's no easy task. You should have a right to be able to have dinner and have some time off as well once in a while. So thank you for taking that time. I do ask that if we continue with North Rink or anywhere else, effective communication would be wonderful. South Euclid had a dog park that was getting renovated the past year. They set up a simple website, and all they did was periodically just drop in some information, and it communicated to all the members of the community. Communications that we received from you came to a select number of people. And when I would post those on Facebook, many community members would come to me and say, where did you get that information? And I said, an email, and that's why I'm sharing it here. So that way, someone else can see it. I don't do public relations. I do IT at Case. I'm not your public relations person. So please have someone communicate to everybody, not just to the select parents that were asking questions. I asked this for this. I asked this for the Cumberland Pool. When we get ready for that project, I understand there's concrete work that's going to get done and boiler's going to get redone, which is great. I love swimming there. But please tell everybody. Please don't tell just the select few that are asking those questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's all.
Okay, committee reports.
Thank you, Madam President. The Planning and Development Committee met this evening at 5 o'clock. I'll keep things short tonight. We discussed Resolution 193-2023 with WXZ, an agreement for Taylor Tutor. And we're going to continue that conversation. In addition, we had a conversation about the shipping container pilot program, and I offered some updates there. We also started having a conversation around the Noble Merchants Association and some of the follow-up work that we're going to be doing. I would encourage everyone to watch that 5 p.m. meeting, and please know that there's going to be one final Planning and Development Committee meeting for the month of December as we wrap some things up and clarify a couple of projects that we're working on. But again, I want to encourage the public to definitely go back and watch that 5 p.m. meeting. It'll offer clarity on several projects happening here in the city. In addition, Planning and Development still has the CIC legislation, three particular pieces inside of P&D that we're also discussing. So we look forward to having that conversation by the end of December as well. Thank you, Madam President.
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, thank you, Madam President. The Parks and Recs and Community Relations will meet this Wednesday, December 6th at 10 a.m. to discuss three pieces of legislation, canine recreation, creating a dog park, ordinance to fund the lifeguards at Cleveland Heights University High School pool, and Employment, Empowerment, and Labor Rights Act. You hear me all the time talking about our employees not making enough money, so I have created legislation to unionize the employees who have not been unionized. It's about 130 of them. I have a sister union, which is AFSCME Ohio Council 8, under Marquise Brown, who is the regional director, who would be glad to unionize these people so they can negotiate their wages and benefits and working conditions. Those are the three pieces of legislation we'll be talking about on Wednesday, December 6th at 10 a.m. in the conference room. And it's also, I don't want to just say one union, but there's another union as well who represent city employees as well. But I'm just tired of our people making $9 and $10, $11 an hour. So I want them to be able to negotiate their wages and benefits.
Okay, well, that being said, we've had, as we mentioned, ARPA will be being voted on the 18th. As will the budget and some of these other legislations that tonight that were just read will be voted on the 18th. Arts Commission will be voted on the 18th with revisions that in part came from feedback of the arts community. So that being said, I think we are adjourned for tonight.